We sadly regret to announce the death of Fernella Husbands Vaughn, better known as Fern or Fernie, of Fort Lauderdale, Florida, formerly of Brooklyn, New York, and Condemn Road, Carrington Village, St. Michael. She was the wife of David Vaughn, mother of Sonia Seal, Adrian Husbands, Juliet Spencer, Shelly Ann Morris, and Michelle Husbands, grandmother of Antoine and Nicola Spencer, Stefan Barker, Akil and Malachi Husbands, great-grandmother of Kaylee Spencer Goodrich and Liam Marshall, sister of Mr. Winston Seal, Anthony Seal, and the late Marion Coppin, aunt of Kevin and Jason Seal of the USA, Javon Kirkland and Leslie Seal, and the late Ryan Coppin, mother-in-law of Jennifer Husbands and Derek Morris, sister-in-law of Patricia and Wendy Ann Seal, cousin of Yvonne and Myrtle Seal, and the Seal and Hoyt families, and many others. Friend of Eugene Scott, Patricia Jemmett, Jan Maskell, Yvonne Hines, Marvita Hoyt Glenn, and Jennifer Diaz of the USA, and many others. The funeral of the late Fernella Husbands Vaughn leaves Belmont Funeral Home on Tuesday, August 8, 2023, for Ebenezer Seventh-day Adventist Church, Eden Lodge, St. Michael, where relatives and friends are asked to meet at 1 p.m. for the service. The funeral will then proceed to the Flamboyant Lawns, Coral Ridge Memorial Gardens, for the interment. The service and burial may be viewed via live stream at www.belmontfuneralhome.live/Fernella Vaughn.
I invite us to stand as we receive the body of our dear sister. Lord, Thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever Thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, Thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction and sayest, "Return, ye children of men, for 1,000 years in Thy sight are as but yesterday, when it is past, and as a watch in the night, Thou carriest them away as with a flood. They are as asleep in the morning, they are as grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. The days of our years are 70. And if by reason of strength they be 80, yet is their strength and labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom." I welcome you to this service of thanksgiving for the life of our dear sister Fernella Arlene Husbands Vaughn. On behalf of the entire family, we want to say thank you for sharing the moments of condolences with them, and thank you for attending this service of thanksgiving this evening. We trust that you will be blessed, we all will be blessed. And the word of God did tell us that those who mourn shall be comforted. And we pray that this service indeed will be a service to give comfort and hope in these times. Just some housekeeping matters. The washrooms are downstairs. The males are on the left and the females are on the right. In the event that there is a need for the use of the washrooms. So once again, welcome, and thanks for coming. I invite you to bow your heads now for a word of prayer. O loving Lord, we are assembled in the quietness of this evening in your presence to thank you, Lord, for lending to us one of your children. We thank you for the tremendous contribution she has made to her family, to her community, to her church, to her friends gathered here this evening. We know, Lord, in these moments, you are always close to us. You promise that those who mourn shall be comforted. You promise that you will give us the Comforter, who is your Holy Spirit. And so today, Lord, we reach out to you. Grant us the confidence and the comfort that we need, and the hope of knowing that one day soon, when death itself shall be no more, when our Lord shall return, you have promised, Lord, to reunite families or loved ones who have fallen asleep in Christ. May this hope buoy our spirits up and give us strength as we face the days ahead. So linger, Holy Spirit, to bless everything that will be said and done today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. We're using the hymn, "Hold Fast till I come. Promises give to all who believe. Behold, I come quickly, my own to receive. Oh, fast till I come, the danger is great. Sleep not as do others, be watchful and wait. Hold fast till I come, the sweet promise of heaven. The kingdom restored to you shall be given. Come enter my joy, bright grounds are in waiting. Hold fast till I come. We'll watch unto prayer with lamps burning bright. He comes to all others, a thief in the night. We know he is near, but knows not the day. As spring shows that summer is not far away. Hold fast till I come, sweet promise of heaven. The kingdom restored, come enter my joy, sit down on my throne. Bright crowns are in waiting, hold fast till I come. Yes, this is our hope, 'tis built on his word. The glorious appearing of Jesus, O Lord. Of promises all, it stands as the sun. Behold, I come quickly. Hold fast till I come. Hold fast till I come, sweet promise of heaven. The kingdom restored to you shall be given. Come enter my joy, sit down on my throne. Bright crowns are in waiting, hold fast till I come. Please remain standing for the first scripture Bible reading, Revelation chapter 21, reading verses 3 and 4.
Good afternoon. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you all for coming. I read from Revelations 21, 3 to 4. And I heard in a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying. Neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. All right, at this time, we will continue with our first tribute.
We had humble beginnings in a home led by a single parent, our mother, Germaine Doreen Seal, who did her utmost to ensure that the family was well provided for. From an early age, great responsibility fell on Fernie, as we fondly called her. She was the eldest. She was expected to maintain order while mommy was out working and to ensure that her siblings, Winston, Marion, and I, did not get out of hand, as she knew what would happen when mommy got home. The four of us enjoyed time with mommy and with each other, like going to the exhibition, Christmas morning, you know, when we went to church, and then afterwards going to Queen's Park, and then caught a bus and go driving through the country, and then go by some of our favorite aunts, and really had a fantastic time. There was also the Civic Day. These were all held in Queen's Park. There were excursions, the sea, the cinema, and to church, where we liked reciting and being involved in all the plays. All of these helped to strengthen the bond between us. The exhibition, which we look forward to every year, was like something like AgriFest today. It was a time to meet friends and have fun, getting treats that we wouldn't otherwise have, and playing all kinds of games. Now, one year, around the exhibition time, Marion and I had one of our little fights. When mommy found out, it was no exhibition for the two of you. Now Fernie started laughing, to which mommy responded, "You're not going either, because you should have stopped them from getting into the fight." That is what mommy expected of Fernie, to take care of her little brothers and sister. Fernie was also held responsible for the things in the house and how they were used. There's one incident that stuck with us over the years, one which whenever we got together, we recapped, and Fern would laugh until water came from her eyes. It brought out the poet in Winston, who penned a poem which began, "One day I was very hungry, so I decided to make some tea. The stove did not have much oil, so I went to the fire outside in the yard for water to boil." Now, I don't remember the words in the middle of the poem, but when the water boiled, Winston just could not find the milk and sugar. He looked and looked and finally gave up. No tea. Now, you know it is said that when you can't find something, stop looking, and it may show up when you are looking for something else. And this certainly happened. Now, Winston had a foot that was giving him some trouble and contributed to solving the mystery of the missing milk and sugar. Now, listen to how he so masterfully completed the poem, which also shows Fern's creativity. He says, "And as I began to look for the oil to rub my foot, under the bed I saw the milk and sugar I was looking for. And as I can remember, it was the 28th day of September in the year 1960, when I wanted to make some tea. Now, this was Fernie again, taking her responsibility seriously. Now, as Fernie started to raise her own family, she was still expected to carry out her big sister role. When she eventually went into her own home, she continued to look out for us. Now, when Mommy transitioned in 1976, I had just completed my first year at university in Trinidad. And Fernie had no problems in carrying on the motherly role to Marion and me, seeing that she was so well prepared. Now, Winston had already gotten married and moved into his own home with his family. Some 4 to 5 years later, Marion got married and moved into her own home, leaving me alone in the family house. By this time, I had graduated and was working. But Fernie continued to be there for me. In particular, she ensured that I had lunch every day. And any of you who have tasted Fernie's hand would know that she could cook. She proudly accompanied me to my graduation ceremony, which was held at Cafil. And she made sure that she was at my wedding, even though it was in Trinidad. Now, through the years, she continued to be a really good and loving sister-in-law to my wife and a caring aunt to my sons. She helped Wendy to become comfortable and settled here in Barbados. As a young wife, Wendy was concerned about her cooking, but Fernie took care of that as well, sharing with her all the tricks to Bajan cooking. Wendy has etched in her mind Fernie's preparation of fish with only onion and garlic for seasoning. Wendy's comment is, "She made our fish taste so good." Now, I believe that taste still lingers with Wendy, as she is seldom satisfied with how her fish tastes. Fernie loved her siblings. In 2002, I was considering a family vacation to the USA. 5 of us in my family. And Fernie said we could stay at her house, as she was then living in New York. I had no idea that she already had a house full. We got there to discover there were about 12 of us in that small apartment. We lived out of our suitcases and slept in various parts of the apartment. Now, Fernie, who was working nights then, would come home in the morning and be ready to take us out and about. And we all know Fern could shop. Fern could walk about. You know? We thoroughly enjoyed that vacation. Now, it was a joy for me in 2017 to take Fernie on a vacation with Wendy and Leslie. We went to Orlando and Daytona Beach. We had a blast together. Long to be remembered on that vacation is a game of mini golf that we all played together. Now, for Marion's retirement, she was rewarded with a cruise, and she was given up on it because she didn't want to go by herself. Fernie, in her own style, told her she was not going to give up such an opportunity, that she would go with her. They went and had a memorable time. As Marion's health deteriorated, and up to her passing in 2016, Fernie would be calling from Florida and regularly coming to Barbados to make sure that things were going all right with Marion. It was similar with Winston, the inseparable bond, Fernie and Winston. And as he continued to face his health challenges, whenever she was in Barbados, she had to spend time with her Winnie. From November last year, Winston and Pat were in Florida, and you could not separate Fernie from Winston. They were together up to when she went into hospital just before her passing. Winston, Marion, and I retired in close proximity. And when Fernie came to Barbados, we would always get together. It was queue in the community and drives to various parts of the island for picnics, lunches with all our families. Now, she enjoyed what we call the Fish Thursdays at Martin's Bay, taking in the sea breeze under an umbrella and partaking of the sumptuous meal. She was always amazed to see the head and the tail of the snapper outside of the food container when it was closed. And those of you who know about Martin's Bay and Fish Thursday will know what we're talking about. Now, these memories will remain with us. I am going to miss my sister, my mother, my friend, who taught me to care for others, to be hard-working, to be a lifelong learner. Now, unlike the other three of us, Fern did not complete secondary school, did not have a university degree, but I tell you, Fern was educated. She taught herself much. And all of this nursing that she does, she taught herself to care for others. I learned that from her. And as many of you might be able to attest, she taught me to shop, where I am comfortable now shopping for my wife. From head to toe, I would shop for my wife. Now, as Proverbs 31 reminds us, who can find a virtuous wife? For her worth is far above rubies. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many daughters have done well, but you excel them all. Charm is deceitful, and beauty is passing. But a woman who fears the Lord shall be praised. Now, Fernie didn't have much to give in terms of worldly goods, but wisdom she did have and hoped you understood. She never looked for praises. She was never one to boast. She just went along simply doing what she loved most. Knowing that she is gone today may bring you hurt and pain, but remember that the time will come when you will meet again. God knew what she was experiencing, even though we could not see. So he put his arms around her and whispered, "Let go and come to me." Rest well, big sis. You have earned it. Farewell. Farewell.
Good afternoon, everyone. Now, a tribute to our friend, Fenella Husbands, Vaughn. Today, I stand to present this tribute on behalf of four dear friends of Fern's. This tribute bears the sentiments of Eugene Scott, Patricia Gemmon, Patricia Hackett, and I, Jan Maskell. We all found Fern to be God-fearing, brave, ambitious, loving, generous, and very caring. She would give away her last and do without. She was very outspoken and courageous. If she had an opinion, she expressed it, no matter what the outcome may be. She never bore malice, but she gently let you know how she felt about a matter. I personally remember Fern as a young lady visiting relatives in Bank Hall in the company of her brother Winston. I remember her as a polite and pleasant young woman. Whenever she visited an uncle who lived next door to my home, she would give a shout out to my family. I, however, lost contact with her for a number of years, but met up again with her when she became a member of the Advent Avenue SDA Church in the 70s. It was also in the early 70s that Eugene first met Fern. She cannot remember how they linked up, but she does remember walking home with her and her children from church a few Sabbaths, soon discovering that they were actually neighbors. From this, they developed a friendship, which lasted until her death. This friendship grew as they visited each other's homes. From their conversations, they realized that in addition to church, they had several things in common. They both enjoyed shopping, going to the beach, picnics, attending concerts and parades. With this acknowledgement, Fern soon joined the company of a small group of us who socialized together and became a friend to all of us up to the day of her passing. At the early stage of our friendship, Fern was the only one in her group with children. Therefore, she was very conscious of the fact that her activities would have to include children. We all had no problem with that, so we would select activities like going to the beach whenever possible, going to picnics, Queen's Park to hear the police band, to watch Donkey Carts Parade, and of course, going to the park on Christmas morning, except if Christmas fell on Sabbath. She also remembers festivals such as NIFCA, the Whole Town Festival, and the Oystein Fish Festival. The highlight of these festivals for Fern and the children was the police tattoo. We all traveled from church to church harvest. It was also a delight for her to see and hear the children as well as the adults perform. When it was possible, Fern would join in attending events such as Bimshire and Tin Pan Alley at Common Mare. Let me tell you something now. Fern was not a night person. She was good company until about 9 o'clock. But after that, she was ready for sleep. When we attended Bimshire shows, we would have to tell her what happened in the second half of the show, because she would fall asleep immediately after the intermission. When she awoke, she would ask for her tea. A cup of tea was a must for her at night. She did not let anything get between her tea and sleep. In fact, she always reminded us that night meant for sleep. And the only cure was for sleep was sleep. We were on a cruise some years ago and Fern fell asleep at the dining table. It was therefore very surprising to learn that Fern chose to work the graveyard shift when she became a nurse in New York. The most hilarious occasion about Fern and sleep was one night we attended an event. Fern was seated near a speaker box. At about 9 o'clock, we realized that it was Fern's sleepy time, and we thought that we should leave. As we were about to inform her, Fern drew her chair closer to the box, rested her head against the box, and went fast asleep. Fern's hobby, as you heard before, was shopping. We had enjoyed many shopping exploits here in Barbados. But our shopping delights really occurred after she moved to New York. We must, however, mention one shopping event in Barbados, which we always joke at. We were always bargain hunters, and so one evening, while we were hanging out in Carnton's Village, we learned that flying fish were selling 10 for 25 cents on the wharf. We decided to go and purchase some. When we got there, the price had gone to 12 for a quarter, or 50 for $1. We soon realized that several boats were coming in and the price was dropping. After several boats landed, we saw another boat in the distance and decided to wait and buy from that boat. Well, to our utter dismay, those fish were sold 10 for the quart. That was the last boat for the night. How dejected we were after waiting for a few hours and refusing to buy 100 fish for a dollar. After making several trips to New York, Fern realized that there were opportunities available which could improve her life and that of her family. And so during the 1980s, she decided to go after these opportunities. She always said that as a child, her ambition was to be a policewoman. This desire was never fulfilled, but being the industrious person she was, as soon as she settled in nursing, as soon as she settled in New York, she took up nursing as a career, the profession she worked at until her retirement. One would have thought that with Fern's relocation, our friendship would wane, but instead it grew deeper and stronger. She never lost touch with us, and she was always happy to know that one of us was coming to New York. On our arrival, we only had to let her know where we were staying, and she would find us. I am baffled. It baffled us to know how she got it done. Fern would work at the night shift, but by 11 o'clock the following day, she was ready to go on shopping expeditions. You only had to tell her what you were looking for, and it would be found. As long as you connected with Fern, you would be sure to cash in on all the bargains that were available because she would make it possible to take you to all the spots. While gathering information for this tribute, Kern, the son of one of our group members, was asked if he had anything to contribute, and he said, certainly. His contribution was also about her love for shopping. He recalled the holidays he spent in New York, how Fern would take him and his mom pack shopping for long hours. He also joked about the fact that although he was eating fast food every day, at the end of his holidays, he was sure to lose 5 pounds as a result of the shopping escapades. I must assure you that it was not all shopping. Come Sabbath mornings, you were expected to attend church with her, after which you were invited to have lunch with her. She made sure we were taken care of on Sabbaths. Fern also enjoyed surprises. We recall a surprise baby shower we threw for her after the birth of her youngest daughter, Michelle. Despite the fact that she enjoyed the party and was very appreciative, she could not understand how we pulled it off, and she did not pick up a clue. Anyhow, she accepted the fact that we loved and cared about her, otherwise we would not have done it, but she was determined to get back at us. Although she had relocated, whenever she heard about any surprise party being planned, she became very excited and would want to play her part. When we surprised our friend Pat with a 60th birthday party, Fern flew home for the event. Her presence at that party was a second surprise for the celebrant because she had wished her birthday greetings that morning, and Pat thought that it was coming from Florida. As was already mentioned before, Fern was caring and loving. Jean recalls an occasion when she and her family were in Fort Lauderdale for an extended period of time and had to stay in a hotel. This made Fern very unhappy and concerned because she was unable to accommodate them. Although Jean tried to assure her that it was all right because it was 5 of them to be accommodated, Fern could not accept the fact that she was unable to accommodate them. Her greatest concern was the expense of the hotel. To gain some measure of satisfaction, she graciously prepared lunch for them every Sabbath and brought it to the hotel. She also invited them to her home for lunch on the Sundays that they were not invited out. For the 2 months they were in Fort Lauderdale, Fern would call every morning to inquire about them and to ascertain that they did not lack anything. These phone calls were usually followed up by an in-person visit during the day. Fern enjoyed lending a helping hand wherever possible, and we greatly appreciate her for that. We always enjoyed the company of each other and eagerly looked forward to occasions when we could be together. In our senior years, our group cruised the Caribbean, and those were 7 marvelous days. Today, we all sadly agree that Fern has given the last and biggest surprise. Although we all know that death is inevitable and that it comes like a thief in the night, never in our wildest dreams would any of us expect to be paying tribute today at Fern's celebratory service. Her passing has left a void in our lives. Fern, our dear friend, a loving and caring person, a true believer in Christ, our sister and confidant, we all hope that on that grand resurrection morning, we'll all meet around God's throne. Our condolences go out to David, her beloved husband, and to her children, Sonia, Adrian, Juliet, Shelley, and Michelle, and to all her other relatives and friends. Rest in peace.
Shall continue with the hymn, My Faith Looks Up to Thee. Let's all stand as we sing together.
My faith looks up to Thee, Thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Now hear me while I pray, take all my guilt away. Oh, let me from this day be holy. Impart strength to my fainting heart, my zeal inspire. As thou hast died for me, oh, may my love to thee pure, warm, and changeless be. I tread, and the griefs around me spread, be thou my guide. May darkness turn to day, wipe sorrow's days away. No, let me ever stray from thee. When life's dreams, when death cold sun stream shall o'er me roll, blessed Savior, then in love, fear and distrust remove.
Be seated. We'll continue with another tribute, and after that we have our scripture reading.
Good afternoon. Fenella Husbands Vaughn was a true example of what a grandmother and a great grandmother should be. She taught us along the way how to be selfless, how to be generous, respectful, loving, thoughtful, and friendly. She also taught us that family is everything. And every opportunity she got, she would tell us who our extended family is. Granny was a great historian and would always tell us family stories from way back when Adam was a lad. But poor me, I haven't even developed that fantastic memory gene as yet. Granny would always say, child, you need ginkgo biloba. always with a smile. She encouraged us that we should believe in ourselves and follow our dreams. Granny has 4 grandchildren, Anton, Akil, Stefan, Malachi, and myself, Nicola. And of course, I'm the favorite because I'm the only girl. And 2 great-grands, my children, Kaylee and Liam, who she all loved dearly. She loved to shop for us, especially our favorite foods like pizza rolls, Velveeta mac and cheese, and cereals of all kinds. Don't get me started on the clothes and the shoes that she would buy. Even if she went to the store for 1 item, Granny would always come back with many buys, and most of the time, we knew that there was always something for each of us. For her great-grandchildren, she would also ensure that she brings toys and clothes for them. When she lived in New York, she would take us to Flatbush and Manhattan, spending hours in Conway and Cookies. Whatever we needed, whatever we wanted, she knew just the store and where to get it from. And don't get me started on the directions to the T. Damn, that woman was a walking map. From the time she moved from New York to Florida, our summers then became trips to Disney World. We went to Disney World with her and for an entire day. She never once fussed about us being up and down and all over the park or how long the lines for the rides were. As long as we were happy, she was also. But I'm pretty sure that we've covered all of those theme parks in Orlando. Our grandmother loved traveling. She has been to several countries, some of which are England, Amsterdam, Paris, and Spain. Our last trip was last Christmas, 4 weeks in Europe. Granny and I spent hours on the phone daily planning and organizing that trip. Where to go, what to do, where to stay, and sometimes even what foods we should try. I am going to miss that the most. Talking to her every day, at least 6 times a day, 7 days a week. Planning our trips, talking about life, looking at clothes and shoes online. Although she was in pain some of the days, she always made the effort to be out and about. Even if it meant that she didn't walk around in the store with us, she would sit and eagerly wait to see whether our purchases were up to her shopping standards. From the words of an unknown author, this poem best describes you. You fed us well, you made us strong. You taught us to know right from wrong. You made us feel that we belong. You showed us value of a song. Birthday cards and birthday greetings you would always send. You knew the value of family and friends. You gave us life, you gave us love. But now you've left us and you've gone to sleep. We are left behind, we have to stay. So now we would just have to pray that we will meet you again another day. You always have that special touch. We love you so very much. Please watch over us from above. Rest in eternity, our dear Granny.
Thank you very much. We welcome you all. I'm Adrian Husbands, and I've been offered by the family to spend a few minutes talking about our mom, whose life we are celebrating today together. My mom would have been very pleased and honored to see you all could make it. But you all can make it here to share in this. As it was her wish for family and friends with whom the most important to her. I'm very grateful of the way I was raised. She always showed us, and I know I had a mom, and we all knew we had a mom. who cared about us. Without her, we will not be here today. I wouldn't be the person I am. And there is no way I could even quantify the importance of her to us all. We miss you, Mom. And we love you. We love you very much. She also wanted me to let you all know that she loves you too. Every one of you that are here right now. I have a message from my wife and the Ghanaian community in the UK and in Ghana and Africa. I read a tribute for you. Thank you for listening. The tribute says, tribute for Fern. You were an independent woman, a free spirit. Your strength of character and broad knowledge on everything. I remember listening in the vibrant conversations between you and Adrian as he tried to recall people and events. However, you were the one with the amazing memory and could put meat on the bones to his recollection. I think I need some drink of Biloca. And to retell events of the past like it was yesterday. I remember how we would converse about nothing in particular, but somehow would be on the phone for ages. I appreciate your zeal for life and independence. When you were traveling last year, you appeared quite unwell, and the general consensus was you shouldn't travel, but you weren't having any of it. Praise God she didn't. I was able to see her and we spent plenty of time in the UK with her last year for my 60th birthday. Okay, I look young, don't worry about it. And the Christmas season, and it was really well, it was good. Thank you. By the time you left the UK, you were feeling great. And we discussed the remarkable difference you had experienced in your general wellness. We were so glad you come and even travel on to Spain. You demonstrated that life is indeed for living and no one knows tomorrow. You were determined to find joy, peace, and enjoy a host of different experiences, even though aches and pains. I have so much admiration for your positive attitude to life. Thank you so much for welcoming me into your family, our conversation, and the Christian guidance. You remind me of my mom and made me miss her even more. Your family in Ghana have all expressed their sadness for your loss, but are comforted that you love the Lord. That's the family in Ghana, Africa. We feel quite out of sorts since you passed. Still stunned. However, in all things, we continue giving thanks to God for your life well lived. Rest in the bosom of our Father. God, my lovely mother-in-law, Fern, we love you always. Rest well. You have finished your race. That was from my wife and the Ghana community. And now I have a poem that I want to read. Just a moment, Pastor. A poem I want to read. And the name of the poem is, Mike, can you all hear me well? Never say goodbye. There can be no goodbyes for us. It'd be too painful there. Our connection still lives on, although we are far from her. I miss the times that were once had, that we once had, sorry. But one day, once again, I'll hold you close and laugh with you. I just wish I knew when. Each moment till that day arrives, until my time is true, I'll miss you more than words can say and always think of you. I'll look for you amongst the stars and each dawn and past the sky and whisper words of love to you, but never say goodbye. That's a poem from all of us, siblings, Juliet, Sonia, Shelley, Michelle. Thank you very much. May God bless you and keep you. And always remember that with God, everything is possible. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Please stand for the second scripture reading. I will be reading John chapter 14, verses 1 through 6. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one come unto the Father but by me. Thank you. Please be seated.
All right, we continue at this point with the eulogy, and after the eulogy there will be a musical tribute.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm the baby, so I get to take my time. Fernella Husbands Vaughn. Fern or Fernie blessed this world with her presence through her mother, Germaine Doreen Seal, in Barbados on Tuesday, October 10th, 1944. She was the wife of the late Jeffrey Husbands, who passed in 1998, and current wife of David Vaughn for 23 years. September 19th, 2023 would be 24 years for them. Her many titles included beloved mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, sister, aunt, cousin, mother-in-law, and friend. We know she was a lover as well, at least six times, since she has five children. And our brother Stephen, who she unfortunately miscarried before I came along and made her world even better with my presence. For 78 years, the Lord allowed her to be with us. During that time, she blessed us, irritated us, cared for us, loved, and prayed for us. As with all of us, her childhood strongly influenced the woman she became. Her dedication to family and close friends was the essence of who she was. As you have heard from some of her family and close friends here today, and from the memories you have of your own. Mom gathered many under her wing and unselfishly shared what she had if people were in need. She was a trusted confidant, personal shopper, doctor, lawyer, advocate, and social worker to many. Her opinions were shared unequivocally, and you just had to deal with them. So can we talk a little bit about her mouth for a minute? She was very outspoken, blunt, forthright, or maybe candid is a better word. And at times your feelings will get seriously hurt by the opinions that she shared, whether you asked for it or not. I, for one, am grateful for having a parent that was able to speak the hard truths and not sugarcoat things. Because of that, she has 4 outspoken children and 1 peacemaker. But you knew in the end that she would sacrifice herself for you, and she did many times. Service to others was one of her innate gifts. She would spend many hours on the phone with her friends, just talking, reminiscing like Yvonne Hines. In the early 1980s, Mom immigrated to the U.S. to create new opportunities for herself and our family, a decision that was difficult for everyone. By this time, she had the 5 most important parts of her life, her children, Sonia, Adrian, Juliet, Shelley, and me. Even though she was not physically present, she made it a priority to remain in contact with calls and letters to her kids and friends. Her example of making hard, difficult decisions, even if she was the only person standing, was such a big part of her that all of her children have the same trait. Leaning on the strengths and skills she gained from caring for her siblings, Mom worked as a home health aide for the Roth family in New York for many years. She then transitioned to work at Kings County Hospital in the psychiatric ward for 16 years as a nurse's aide until her and David retired to Florida in 2008. Because Mom came from humble beginnings, she understood the value of a dollar. So much so that years after retiring to Florida, she still compared the prices at the grocery stores in Florida to what she would have gotten in New York. And she did that when she visited us in California as well. She would want you to drive 10 miles to save a dollar off a pound of whatever, of course not factoring the cost to the drive. Or she would want you to double back to another store because they had a better deal. I know many of you benefited from her negotiating skills, but some of us have hip problems because of all the walking around, and David just started to drop her off at the stores instead of going inside with her. Mom was an avid traveler, known for her penchant for taking pictures and creating memories with family and friends. She has left hundreds and hundreds of pictures documenting moments for her family and friends to laugh and reminisce over. She was the historian in the family. Her memory was phenomenal right up to the end. And it was not unusual for her to regale others with stories, events, and important dates related to the family, some of which folks wish she had forgotten. And let me tell you, she believed she was a fashion queen. It was not unusual to hear her say, "You're not coming behind me looking like that." But when we looked at some of these outfits and hairstyles going through the pictures, we have plenty of black male material for a lot of you here today. When Mom came home, she always looked up friends and families from years ago. And for some reason, she always would have at least 1 funeral that she would go to. She would actively peruse the obituaries. And if she knew you as a friend of a friend, she was always there to support. Her love for the Lord, once she made the decision to be baptized into the Seventh-day Adventist faith as a teenager, guided decisions that she made. Of course, not all the decisions were great ones, but through the mistakes, she learned lessons that informed her next move for the better most of the time. Mom served faithfully at every church she attended in many positions. I think the only one she didn't have was the role of pastor. Service to others was one of Mom's driving forces. Mom believed in the second coming of Christ and strived every day to live a life that would be pleasing to him. It was her desire that everyone with whom she had a relationship knew God and of his saving grace, so she shared him with all she encountered. Mom was a bright star, nurturing, loving, opinionated, trustworthy, and loyal. Even when she was not feeling well in May and was barely able to move, she was determined to make it to my ordination as an elder in California. And she did, and then I returned to Florida with her for another 6 weeks to assist. She is missed immensely by her husband, children, grandchildren, extended family, and her many friends. But we find strength in knowing that she fulfilled her mandate here on earth, living for Christ alone and leading others to follow his way. I'm going to ask the children and grandchildren and great-grands to stand at this time. If you could face the audience. We are the legacy of Fernella Arlene Seal Husbands Vaughn, a woman who feared God, a woman of resilience, a woman who lived service to others, a woman we called, David, you need to be standing as well. Stand, please. Stand and face. A woman we called wife, mom, granny, and grand-grand, and whose void will never be filled in our lives. We thank you for being here with us today. You can sit. Good evening. Oh, there. Hello, you can hear me? How beautiful heaven will be. Sweet home for the pure and the free. Gift to us for eternity. How beautiful heaven will be. We read of the place that's called heaven. Is there for the pure and the free? These truths in God's word he has given. Only love, peace in God's light will be there. Does Jesus care when our heart is pain so deeply for Fern, our mom? It's as the sorrow press, oh Lord.
sad heart aches as we see not her face, her voice we no longer will hear. Oh, yes, he cares. I know he cares. His love so deeply displayed. When the peace appears to take my pain, I know my Savior came. I knew our Savior cares.
Amen, amen. I know my Savior cares. Once again, on behalf of the church here at Ebenezer, we want to extend condolences to her husband and all children, grandchildren, and all gathered here this afternoon. I propose for the next few minutes to share with you a message of hope from the Word of God. I'm reading for you from the book of John, John chapter 3, and I'm reading verses 16 and 17. John chapter 3, I'm reading verses 16 and 17. We are hoping to get some help from the screen. All right. Before I begin, I just want to let you know I'm a pastor. I'm not a politician. I'm not a medical doctor. I'm a pastor. So as a pastor, I have to talk to you about the love of God. Amen? Talk to me now. Amen? Yeah, I'm a pastor. And as a pastor, I speak to you about the love of God. And that is what I will do for the next few minutes. You're not going to be very long as we make our way to Coleridge. John chapter 3, reading verses 16 and 17. The Word of God says, "For God so loved people. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that anybody, whosoever believes in him should not what? Perish." It didn't say you're not going to die. So you will not perish, but you shall have what? Everlasting life. It continues verse 17. "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but God sent his Son into the world that the world through him might be saved." Would you say amen, somebody? Please bow your heads with me for a word of prayer. Loving Lord, for the next few moments, I just want to stand and talk to those of us who are alive about your love. We thank you for lending to us your daughter. And now that she has laid down the burdens of life, we who are alive and remain, I pray, God, that we will so live as she lived, committing her life to you, enjoying life with her family, but yes, committing her life to you. And now she awaits the resurrection when our Lord shall return in glory to take all his believing children to give to them eternal life with you in heaven. Bless us as we open your word. Send your Holy Spirit, Lord, to give comfort. And for these mercies, we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, when I read the Bible, I told you I'm a pastor, so I have to read the Bible. And I read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. There's one amazing thing I discover about God, and it is that he loves people. Amen? He loves all people.
black people, white people, Latinos, Chinese, Amerindian. He just loves people. It didn't say he loves good people. He loves people, whatever the circumstance of life. So it doesn't matter the color of our skin or the tint of our hair or nationality. God simply loves people. And it is not a permissive kind of love that says, I love you, so you can do what you feel like, do what you like, and then when you die, you turn up in heaven. It's not that kind of love. Are you hearing me? All right. So he loves people, and he has one desire for people, and that all people be saved. Now, he has promised in his word, we read it earlier, he said, anybody that believes in him will not perish. To perish means to cease to exist. People will not perish, but he says he's going to give to them eternal life. Anybody wants eternal life? You don't like living? But talk to me, man. You don't like living? Of course. We enjoy life. And we enjoy living. And God just says, if you give me some of your time, I'm going to give to you, when this moment comes, I will give to you everlasting life. All right. And so, I believe that it is God who keeps us alive every day. You understand that? When you wake up in the morning, because God loves people, when you wake up on mornings, you did not wake up yourself. The alarm clock did not wake you up. It is God that wakes us up every morning. You remember that song? New every morning is the love or awakening and uprising proof. Alarm clocks don't wake up people. If you take the alarm clock down by the morgue, it will ring whole day. Alarm clocks don't wake up people. It is the goodness of God that you are alive today. Are you listening to me? And any morning you wake up and you find that you can take your feet off your bed before you go about your business, at least say, thank you, Lord. Amen, church? Yes, man. Don't just get up and go. Because if God don't keep us, we cannot keep ourselves. The Bible tells us in Acts chapter 17 and verse 28, the Apostle Paul reminds us in Acts chapter 17 and verse 28, Paul says, for in him we live and move and have our being. It is because of God that we are alive. In other words, when sickness comes, it is God who restores us. It is not the medication alone. It is the goodness of God. There are a lot of other people who had the same sickness, took the same medication, and they're not here with us today. God has been merciful to you and to me one more time. Amen? Mm-hmm. It is God. When we acquire means, it is God. The Bible tells us in Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 18, but thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth. It is God that keeps us alive, gives us strength so that we can accumulate resources for ourselves, for the comfort of ourselves and our families. Are you listening? I'm coming to a point that I want you to appreciate and to understand. The Bible tells us in Psalm 91 and verse 3, the Bible says, he will keep you safe from all hidden dangers and from all deadly diseases. Psalm 91 and verse 3. So God is a God that protects us. Do you know that you can be driving on your side and somebody on the other side, under the influence of water, come and wipe you out? So when you reach home on evenings, again, it is the goodness of God that keeps us alive. When the challenges of life come our way, do you know that we can call on God for help? The Bible tells us in Psalm 46 and verse 1, Psalm 46 and verse 1, it says, God is our refuge. God is our strength. He's a what? Present help in time of trouble. So long before ICBL got their jingle, always there when you need us most. God is with us when we need him most. Would you say amen? Amen. So God not only loves us and provides for us and protects us, but our God is a merciful God that desires our good. The Bible says in Psalm 34, verses 4 to 8, I'm reading it for you. Psalm 34, reading from verse 4. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and he delivered me from some of my fears. All right, all of my fears. Next slide, verse 5. They looked unto him and were lightened, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, and the Lord saved him out of what? All his troubles. Verse 7, next slide. The Bible tells me that the angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him and does what? And delivers them. In other words, saints, there are persons who get involved. Let's suppose you get involved in an accident. And you come away from the accident, and some people say they were lucky. Folk, let me tell you something. Lucky died a long time ago. It is the goodness of God that protects you. Are you hearing me? And this is why I'm trying to say to us this afternoon, yes, enjoy life. Yes, accumulate resources for your family. Yes, have a good career. These things are important. But during the process of one's life, one should have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you say amen? Amen. Verse 8 tells us something. Oh, taste, man. And see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that does what? Trusteth in him. Some folks say church is boring. That is not true, saints. I look forward to you. Man, I am so happy serving the Lord. Are you hearing me, brethren? It is the best thing anyone can do to serve the Lord with gladness. The Bible says, come into his presence with singing. Because of what God has done in your life, you can rejoice in knowing that the God we serve is a God that cares about us. More than that, he is willing to forgive us our sins and to remove from us the burdens of guilt. There is one thing that all of us can testify of, is that we have something called memory. And memory has this habit of bringing back to our minds some mistakes that we have made in the past. It doesn't happen to you, but it happens to me. Are you listening? But one thing I have discovered, when memory brings back the bad things or the mistakes I would have made, I can go to God and again be assured. God says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us, rub it out from all unrighteousness. Would you say amen? Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 to 30, the word of God says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. And what happens? Yes, man, I will give you rest. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and you will find rest in your souls, for my yoke is easy and your burden is light. All right, let me try to wrap up what I'm saying this afternoon to you. There is no celebration in heaven when someone falls asleep in death. There is no celebration in heaven. And when we grieve the loss of our loved ones, we do not grieve alone. The word of God tells us that Jesus, surely, Isaiah says, he has borne our griefs and he has carried our sorrows. So when we grieve, when we cry, when we shed tears, understand that the God we serve is close by and he has promised to do something about this thing called death one of these days. Thank God for Jesus Christ. Amen. And here's a promise to those who have fallen asleep in Jesus, for the family members, in the book of Psalm, the 116th division of the Psalm. I'm reading for you verse 15. Psalm 116 and verse 15. The Bible says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Are you hearing me? Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his. In other words, God is saying to you, when one of his children fall asleep in death, as I said, there's no celebration in heaven, but God marks that moment. God will mark the spot where we will lay to rest our sister today. And on that grand resurrection morning, when our Lord shall return in glory, and it shall happen, the Bible says the dead in Christ shall live again. Would you say amen? Amen. The dead in Christ shall live once again. All right. We deserve death because of sin. And the Bible tells us that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. I'm going to read one final text for you this afternoon as we conclude. 1 Thessalonians. We're skipping the other text. We're reading 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I'm reading verses 13 to 18. This is my last text as I conclude. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, reading verses 13 to 18. The word of God says, But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that is, those who have died, that you sorrow, yes, but do not sorrow like others who don't have a hope. Verse 14, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even though with them which sleep in Jesus, will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. It continues, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. And guess what will happen? The dead in Christ shall live again. Would you say amen? Well, listen. I've come by to tell you this afternoon, I may never have an opportunity to do so. I've come by to tell you this afternoon, it is okay to have a good education. Hello? It's okay to have a good home. It's okay to have a good family. It's okay to enjoy life. But God has given us probationary time here on this earth. Are you listening to me? The probationary time that God has given to us. Well, I like to put it this way. And one sister on the church reminded me, we are in the departure lounge. You know that? And one day, I don't know what your number will be, or my number will be, but one day, our number shall call. And let me say this to all of you. You don't live as you like and do as you please, and then turn up in heaven. It don't work so. Are you hearing me? You must have, during these probationary moments that God has given to us, you must make up your mind, whosoever believeth on him shall not perish, man. He has promised, yes, we lay down the burdens of life and death. But he says, but the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the Bible says, the dead in Christ shall live again. That's my hope. That's our sister's hope. That has to be your hope. Don't just... You getting my point? You look real serious though, you know. But I hope you're getting my point. And listen, if somebody tells you about the love of God and that God loves you, don't get vexed. Thank them for reminding you that God loves you. Are you hearing me? My prayer today, let me finish, just read the text for... For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Let's listen to Paul, verse 17. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever, that's eternal life, huh? We ever be with the Lord. I have pledged, I've not been living too long, but I have pledged to give my life over to the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? You may not agree with me. That's your choice. I heard someone said, and it's true, I'd rather live for Jesus like our sister did. I'd rather live for Jesus, live believing there's a God, and die and find out that there's no God, than to live believing as though there is no God and then die and find out there's a God that you have now to give an account for the life he has given to you. I challenge you today, on the authority of God's word, have a good education, have a good life, have a good family. But in the probationary moments God has given to you and to me, make decisions for where you will spend your eternity. Amen, church? Whosoever believeth on him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. Amen. Comfort one another with these words. I'm going to pray a prayer of comfort for you at this time. And maybe you've never made a serious, important decision for the Lord. I challenge you today to do it. And I'm going to pray a special prayer for us. And if it is your desire to be saved when our Lord shall return in glory, please stand with me for this prayer of comfort. Please stand. Shall we bow our heads for a word of prayer? Almighty God, most wonderful Father, we are assembled in your presence this afternoon to celebrate the life of one of your children. You've given her to her husband, to her children, the extended members of the family. We've heard in the tributes so many wonderful things about your daughter. We thank you that during the course of enjoying her life, she made important decisions for salvation. So today, we are assembled for this service of thanksgiving, thanking you for lending her to her family and to her friends. And dear God, at this time, I just want to commit them now into your hands. There's grief, there's sorrow, there is sadness. But you've promised in your word that those who lay down the burdens of life, those who have fallen asleep in Christ, those who are faithful unto death, you said you're going to give to them a crown of life. We believe your word. And even though there is sorrow and grief in our hearts, there is hope. Hope that one day Jesus shall return. One day, Lord, he shall come and our sister shall live again. I pray for the family members in particular. Lord, I pray that they would so live as she did, that on that grand resurrection morning, they will be reunited, never to part again. I want also, Lord, to pray for those of us who are here, many here. Maybe there's someone here who has never made a serious commitment to serve you. I pray you will help us to understand that death is a reality for all of us. And you have told us in these probationary moments of life that you have given to us on this earth to make sure we spend some time thanking you, praising you, worshiping you, surrendering our lives to you. And dear God, I pray that maybe someone is making up their mind even today. Accept them. As they come to you, you promise that you will in no wise cast away. So, Father, I pray you will bless your congregation today. Give them comfort. Give them hope. Give them peace and the assurance that God has promised one day death itself shall die. And if we are wrong to witness the funeral of death, we shall live forever. Whosoever believeth in you, Lord, will not perish, but shall have everlasting life. Grant us that comfort. Grant us that hope. And save us when you come. This is my prayer. In Jesus' precious name, amen. 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 Please be seated. And this time we're going to have some acknowledgments. And after the acknowledgement, we're going to sing that song, What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms as we leave the sanctuary today. So please come forward, those who are appointed, to do the acknowledgments, and then we will have the benediction and the hymn to conclude.
Good afternoon. Today we want to thank all of you who are here present for those who gave us kind words, who prayed for us, who gave us gestures here in Barbados, and those persons in Florida. For your several telephone calls, we want to say all of those things really made a difference in our lives. We knew that you were out there for us and that we can call on you if we get too sad or if we need further words of comfort. We want to say a great thank you to God for granting Fernella with over 70 years, leaving a legacy for her children and grandchildren and extended family to follow. We also wish to thank those who gave the great tributes, although they were family tributes and very close friends. We want to say that as children and as a child of Fern sitting there and listening, I often wonder, and I wondered more so than ever, how she managed to do so much in the time she had. It had to be God-given. I am saying that I see her as an angel sent to earth to bless us and to let us see how we should be with others. It isn't always very easy, but we ask that God will continue to teach us and that we will follow his lead. We want to say thank you to the pastor and members of the Ebenezer Seventh-day Adventist Church who graciously agreed to have this service at their sanctuary. We want to say thank you to the members of the Belmont Funeral Home who have conducted and has helped us along the way in planning the service. We want to say a special thank you for the lovely corsages that were made by Jennifer from England, Adrian's wife. She wanted to be here, but unfortunately she couldn't, and she has reminded us through her craft and her loving artwork that she's here with us still. We want to especially thank the ushers, Patricia and Bruce, Samantha and Liana, who have guided you to your seats and given you your leaflets. If I have forgotten anyone, please forgive me at this time. Thank you.
I just want to add, I thank you for each and every one. We know that death is something none of us can get accustomed to. But with the help and the courage of God, you can carry on. So thank each of all of you for making this occasion what it is. May we all live in peace and harmony until that time. Hey, thank you.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, just one last thank you. We want to say thank you to Rosie, who made a special effort, who we changed our minds a couple of times, but she graciously, we will see her artwork later on here at the funeral spread that's on the casket, and then in the wreaths that she would have made for us. So thank you so much, Rosie.
Amen. Now I invite you to stand for the benediction and for our final hymn that we can sing from your leaflets, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Let's bow our heads for the benediction. Now, our Heavenly Father, we've come to the end of this service of thanksgiving for your daughter, Sister Vernella. We thank you for the contribution she's made to her family and to her loved ones. We're about now to proceed to her final resting place, knowing, Lord, that your promise, one day when you shall return, those who fall asleep in Christ shall live again. Please, our safety lies only with you, so go with us and take us safely and bless. Continue to bless this family, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Let's sing it together.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path it grows from day to day. That's why I'm leaning, leaning. Oh, why I'm safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning on Jesus, leaning. Oh, I am leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with mine. Leaning on the everlasting, so I am leaning on Jesus Christ, my Savior, from all alarms. Leaning on Jesus, oh, I am leaning on the everlasting arms.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name.
the sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy. Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness.
Oh, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees.
Ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. sings, my soul, my Savior, God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God to thee.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the Your name is great and singing 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His soul. Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
forever will be great. the depths of the sea. Creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring.
Let us begin. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Now, our Heavenly Father, we are about to tenderly commit the body of your daughter, Fernella Arlene Husbands Vaughn. We are about to tenderly commit her body to the earth. We do so with the assurance and the promise of your word that one day soon, Jesus shall return for all his believing children. We pray, O God, that holy angels will mark this spot. Angels that walk with your daughter during her journey of life, will mark this place. And on that grand resurrection morning, you said, Lord, that the dead in Christ shall rise first. She, on the authority of your word, will hear your voice, the voice of the life giver, and will live again this time for eternity. Comfort the family at this moment, Lord. Put your arms of love and strength around each member of the family. And grant that on that grand resurrection morning, having been faithful as she was, may they be reunited, never to part again. Into your hands then we commit this aspect of our service. In Jesus' name, amen. For as much as God in his infinite wisdom and mercy have permitted our dear sister Fernella Arlene Husbands Vaughn to fall asleep in Christ, we do tenderly commit her body to the ground. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in the sure and certain hope of a joyful resurrection when our Lord shall return in glory, when this body of our humiliation shall be changed and made like unto your glorious body. Amen. We are singing the hymn, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. And secure from all alarms, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, I'm leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning on the everlasting.
What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I'm so glad I learned to trust him. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that he is with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust him. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that he is with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, for grace to trust him more.
And I, John, saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, and I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. We're marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. Come, we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known.
Oh, tempting me.
For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. For whether we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord. So whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's. We're going to sing that beautiful hymn, I am pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound, the Lord plant my feet on the higher ground.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, still praying. Some may dwell where these abound. My prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My faith on Canaan's stable land, a higher grain than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher
Oh,
A man that is born of a woman is of few days and full of trouble. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. He fleeth also as a shadow and continueth not. Seeing his days are determined, the number of his months are with thee. Thou hast appointed his bounds that he cannot pass. So man dieth and wasteth away. Yea, man giveth up the ghost, and where is he? As the waters fail from the sea, and the floods decayeth and drieth up, so man lieth down and rises not till the heavens be no more. They shall not be awake nor be raised out of their sleep. If a man die, shall he live again? All the days of my appointed time will I wait till my change come. Thou shalt call, and I will answer. We are singing the hymn, To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Has Done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that everybody can go in. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Jesus himself who said, Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. And I will receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? And Jesus' response was, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Okay, we've come to the end of this service of thanksgiving for their sister, Vernella. On behalf of the family, I would like to thank all of you for your calls, your cards, your words of condolences that you have shared with this family in this their time of deep sorrow and bereavement. They've lost a significant other. Amidst the grief and the sorrow, there is hope. Hope in the coming of the Lord. And because our sister, during the course of her life, made plans for after death, we have that assurance that if we too live as she did, committing our lives to Christ, we will be reunited, never to part again. I invite you, therefore, to keep all members of this family in your prayers. My desire for the family is you continue to live in love and unity, one with another, and also live for Jesus, so that on that grand resurrection morning, you can be, you will be reunited, never to part again. We're about now to have the benediction, and so I invite you to bow your heads for the final word of prayer. And now, our Heavenly Father, we have tenderly committed the body of your daughter to the earth. We do so with the assurance that the dead in Christ shall live again. Once again, I pray, Lord, that holy angels will mark this spot. And when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright, and fair, our desire is that our dear sister, on the authority of your word and her love for Jesus, we believe that she shall live again. Continue now, dear God, to put your loving arms of comfort around each member of the family. Yes, they sorrow, but not as those who have no hope. So grant them that peace, that assurance of your presence and strength as they face the days ahead. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace now and forevermore. Let everybody say, amen, 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 amen. Amen.
The Lord.